I'm Mark Birch. I'm the City Engineer and Public Works Director for the City of White Bear Lake. Water quality is important to everyone. Preserving water quality is a challenge that seems to grow more complex with each passing year. It's a responsibility that we all share, and it's a priority nationwide, not just here in Minnesota. There are numerous factors and variables which impact and determine water quality. One of them is stormwater management. Stormwater management is where a city can seem like a daunting task. Some municipalities may just feel overwhelmed, not knowing where to start or what to do first. I've been there. The City of White Bear Lake has firsthand experience with projects. So do other cities. You aren't alone. The guidance provided in this video is intended to help you learn how to start doing stormwater projects. It's offered by cities for cities. It doesn't focus on all aspects of water quality, but it won't give you all the answers to all your questions. But the guidance provided here will give you some framework and the big picture and help you get started.
All right, right now, Maplewood, we are doing a re-inventory of our entire system. So all of our ponds, pipes, outfalls, we're really trying to take a good first step in getting all the accurate information. Once we do that, the next step is inspecting what we have, so ponds, seeing if we have sediment in ponds, so doing that throughout the system, and then prioritizing to see where we want to spend money to clean out these ponds and perform those dredging projects. So it's important that you spend the dollars where you're doing the most good. So having the inventory, inspection, and prioritization is very important in setting up a program, and then that will allow you to make a good decision on actually picking the projects where you're hiring a contractor and actually doing the work. So there are a number of steps that you have to take, but it can do a lot of good in having that accurate information up front. So this is our Edgerton Pond and area in Maplewood. It's a low area, and most recently we've just installed a temporary pump, and we've been doing this for the past few years. Combination is possibly due to additional sediment in the pond and just the additional storms we've been receiving. But every year this is a burden upon the staff. It takes time and money. And really, if these ponds don't have their proper capacity for these storms and holding that water, these are the types of things that cities need to do to address that. So ensuring your stormwater ponds are functioning as designed is important. So part of that is making sure you're clearing your sediment deltas, and if you need a large-scale sediment removal project, cities really need to start planning for those types.
Drawing water down in a pond should ensure pipes or hoses are not in direct contact with the bottom, or pumping in a way that disturbs the bottom sediment, which would create turbid water downstream. A simple rule of thumb would be, keep it clear.
In White Bear Lake, we found the easiest time of the year to do the project was in the winter, when the sediment was frozen and could be easily excavated. However, it could be done in the summertime using hydraulic dredging or other methods.
Sediment excavation projects are recommended to take place during the winter. Doing the projects in the winter has the following advantages. It provides weather conditions that greatly reduce the risk that rain may cause erosion or turbid runoff may cause erosion. Excavations typically occur in soft soil conditions, which make trucking operations difficult or impossible. Soft soils can be frozen solid during sub-zero conditions, making access with trucks a lot easier. Residents and neighbors have closed windows in the winter, and this means less noise, less dust, and less disturbance. Water remaining after drawdown pumping will freeze solid and can be skimmed off with a dozer piling the ice in the pond. Turbid water locked in ice will remain in the pond when warm weather and the spring thaw turn it back to liquid, keeping the remaining sediment in the pond. Winter excavation projects do have a few drawbacks, and these include working shorter days, working in sub-zero temperatures, and the use of lights after dark to extend the workday if necessary. Site access can be a big problem for cities. Many of the constructed ponds are in subdivisions with homes completely circling the pond. Cities need to work with landowners to cooperatively determine the best access points. This might require legal easements, access through parkland, or removing fences, landscaping, or temporary structures like sheds or playground equipment. Once sediment is removed from the basin, final grading should achieve a natural or gradual slope for all the banks. Ice and snow stockpiled at the site should be evenly distributed throughout the basin. Temporary stabilization of slopes and banks should ensure control of erosion and prevent site runoff during spring snow and the season's first rain events. Cleanup and removal of temporary haul roads should be done while you are working your way out of the site. Once you remove equipment and temporary infrastructure, such as haul roads and rock entrances, it will be cost prohibitive and essentially impossible to make additional corrections. So make sure you think through this carefully before you remove any of your temporary infrastructure.
The city might want to consider surveying when the job is bid as an excavated quantity of sediment. In other words, you know, how much are they going to take? We got to verify what they're taking. We also have to know that we're not disturbing the bottom of the pond.
Stormwater ponds immediately adjacent to a lake, stream, or river represent additional risk, especially if the adjacent waters are not yet impaired. In some cases, the receiving water may already be impaired, so making improvements is more difficult if stormwater ponds are not functioning properly and have direct discharge to the receiving water.
Public relations is incredibly important to the city. We use various communication tools such as websites, newsletters, direct mailings, informational meetings, even face-to-face contact, going and knocking on people's doors to get the information out to them.
Yeah, we found that it was really important to keep open lines of communication between we neighbors and the city before and during the project. I was the, I guess you could call the pond captain, and I had everyone's email address, and we kept everybody up to date by email. Everybody knew just what was going to happen when, and things went really quite smoothly.
The residents in White Bear Lake who live on stormwater ponds value not only the water quality improvements that the ponds make, but they also value the wildlife that uses them, the turtles, the frogs, the fish, the ducks and geese that inhabit the stormwater ponds that are in our community.
Stormwater ponds have functional value for flood control and to keep pollution out of our lakes and rivers. However, over time, these stormwater collection and conveyance structures have evolved aesthetic value in most communities. Residents bordering ponds sometimes construct elaborate landscaping, connecting their yard to the pond. Landscaping timbers, patio blocks, rock and sand beaches, and ornamental shrubbery are not uncommon. Many residents maintain docks, paddle boats, canoes, kayaks, and sometimes even motor boats. It's commonplace to see benches, patio furniture, and decks overlooking the water. Chemical treatment of the ponds with aquatic herbicides is also commonplace to kill algae and weeds to prevent the pond from becoming green or choked with weeds during the summer months. Enjoying stormwater ponds for the aesthetic value is understandable, but cities need to remind residents that these are not places for recreation. Swimming and wading should be discouraged. Health risks associated with stormwater sediment are not well understood. Short-term exposures directly to contamination in the sediment can cause rashes or irritation. Washing with soap and water after direct contact is advised. In addition, it's possible that long-term exposures to contamination in stormwater ponds could cause additional health problems. The Minnesota Department of Health does not have data on contamination in fish from stormwater collection systems. There is no specific advice about consumption of fish from these ponds.
The cost implications to cities with the coal tar sealant and PAH contamination is huge. Cities really need to start looking at this issue. When you have cost to dredge out a pond, that could be triple the typical cost. That has huge implications. So looking at $45 a cubic yard for project cost compared to maybe $15 for uncontaminated sediments, cities really need to start planning for this. And it's an emerging issue, so I'd encourage cities to really take steps in limiting PAH contamination and really planning their overall program. Site restoration is an important factor as you complete your project.
getting the site restored and ground cover established as soon as you can, as soon as weather permits in the spring, if you do it in the winter like we've been doing. Some important things to remember is get your haul roads established, get them graded while you still have equipment in the area. Get those areas that are above the water line reseeded as quickly as possible. Maintain your silt fence until all of your areas have been reestablished. And then work on your higher areas. Get those things seeded or mulched so that you can prevent erosion, both wind and water erosion coming on your site.